as we wait for Finetta, and hopefully she'll be here, that we go around and just sort of, I mean, our names are written on the screens, but at the same time, you might just say where you are or something about what you bring to this conversation, very, very short, like in 4 words. And if you don't have your video on, please do so we can see you. Or Alex, it's okay, we can see your face because you have your face even though it's not a video. It's very nice. Paul, you want to start?
Sure. I'm Paul Majewski. I'm at Ball Cornell Medicine in the Center for Research and End of Life Care. And I guess my most direct tie to this workshop would be my working in bereavement and prolonged grief. And those who have prolonged grief disorder are at elevated risk for at least suicidal ideation. So there's a risk factor there.
Okay.
And we've been developing an online bereavement resource so that people who are bereaved can come and work on, let's work on their grief. And we became concerned when we found that a lot of individuals who came to the site, obviously many of them had either qualified for prolonged grief disorder, at least with a brief screen, and many of them were bereaved by suicide, sort of a many more than we would have expected. So we became concerned that we need to have some sense that maybe some of our, maybe many of the people coming to our website might be at risk for suicide. And we developed an NIMH R21, which is now funded to look at ways of detecting suicide risk among people who are using our bereavement resource online.
Thank you. Why don't other people who didn't speak yesterday sort of introduce yourselves? Lisa?
Sure. Hi, my name is Lisa Berry. I'm an associate professor of psychiatry at the UConn School of Medicine and the Center on Aging. I'm a chronic disease epidemiologist by training, and my research now largely focuses on mental health outcomes in older prisoners, individuals who are both incarcerated and those who are transitioning from prison back to the community. I think the population that I work with, it has a really unique definition of social isolation because in fact, you know, they're in a location with many other individuals, but yet at the same time can feel quite isolated, obviously from their family and friends. And then once they're released, there is a very high risk of suicide and overdose in individuals who've been released from prison in older age, but basically within that first year in particular. So thanks. Looking for ways to potentially
You're at UPenn?
UConn.
UConn, that's what I thought.
University of Connecticut.
A big life event. Pat Rowe?
No.
Hi there. I'm a clinical psychologist, professor in the Department of Psychiatry at the University of Washington. And my research focuses on the feasibility and effectiveness of lay-delivered interventions for depression in senior center, and have sort of moved on to, with COVID, sort of increasing the capacity of non-clinical staff to deliver depression-specific and also prevention interventions remotely. And I'm thinking of also about kind of expanding to suicide prevention efforts in the same settings. And very challenging because these are staff in both senior centers and also moving to low-income public housing that who don't look at it as their job to do these kind of a things. So, but building on sort of the culture of health promotion efforts there to kind of see if there's some room to develop there.
Paul, the other Paul Duberstein.
Hi, Paul Duberstein here. I'm a clinical and community psychologist by training. I'm now professor and chair of the Department of Health Behavior, Society, and Policy at the Rutgers School of Public Health. And I'm here, I think, because I was Yates Conwell's first mentee. And I worked with him on the groundbreaking psychological autopsy study of late life suicide in Western New York. And I'm now just a gris eminence, an old person who's been hanging around for a long time and has a lot of thoughts. Thank you.
Emphasize a lot of thoughts. Brianna?
Hi, I'm Brianna Mezick. I am at the University of Michigan in the Center for Social Epidemiology and Population Health. I'm trained as an epidemiologist, and the last few years have been doing work on kind of the relation between depression and frailty, particularly, and then that has now moved into sort of what are the settings in which people who both have depression and frailty may be, and so that's led us to work on suicide risk in long-term care settings, so sort of assisted living and nursing homes. Do quite a bit of work with that on the National Violent Death Reporting System data, including using now working with people from the School of Information to use natural language processing algorithms to analyze these text narratives that are associated with each of the observations in that data set. So when which is a over 200,000 suicide deaths is what we're analyzing now to look at how life transitions, including the transition or anticipated transition into residential care may be related to suicide risk. And it's a pleasure to see everyone, especially people I've missed seeing your faces.
Sarah? Hi, I'm Sarah Saja. I'm a professor of gerontology and director of Center on Aging and Behavioral Research at Weill Cornell Medicine. I used to be at the University of Miami for many years. My work as part of a CREATE team, which is an NIH-funded center focusing on aging and technology, has been on looking at ways that we can bring technology-based interventions to isolated older adults to foster social connectivity, social engagement. The PRISM system was mentioned in an earlier talk today, and it's the PRISM system was a system that, it's a software system that CREATE developed. And we got very nice findings in terms of people. We employed the system with older adults who lived alone, were at risk for isolation, and got very nice findings in terms of enhancing their feelings of social support and reducing loneliness. We're now expanding that and looking at the efficacy with people with mild cognitive impairment. And I'm pleased to say that, and by the way, I work right down the hall from Paul when we're not in COVID. I'm pleased to say that we've been able to modify our protocol so we can totally do this virtually, the whole trial now during COVID, and keep people using the system. So that's been very exciting.
That's great. Nancy, we're just going around so that people who did not talk yesterday get a chance to introduce themselves, and that leaves us with Chip and Laura. So Chip.
Hi, Marty. Thank you. Chip Reynolds. I'm an emeritus professor of psychiatry at Pittsburgh and have done intervention research, both prevention and treatment of mood disorders in older adults, sponsored by NIMH and PCORI. One of my interests, particularly in collaboration with Marty, has been on the intersection between behavioral health care services and primary medical care services, as in the PROSPECT study, which Holly mentioned earlier today. I also have an interest in global mental health issues and recently completed and published a study on the prevention of depression in older primary care patients in Goa, India, which is a collaboration with Vikram Patel. My other hats these days, I serve as editor of the American Journal of Geriatric Psychiatry, and I'm a member of the Lancet World Psychiatric Association Commission on Depression. We anticipate publishing that probably early next year. And it covers quite a bit of territory like we've been doing today or in this workshop. And finally, I would just mention seeing my colleague and friend, Paul Masiejewski. I've been engaged in research on the diagnosis and treatment of prolonged grief disorder. And Paul and I, together with Holly Prigerson, Kathy Shear, and others, are engaged now with Paul Applebaum and colleagues at the American Psychiatric Association in an effort to mainstream diagnostic criteria for prolonged grief disorder. We seem to be making some progress there. As you know, it had been a part of Appendix 3 in the 2013 DSM, but now we hope to mainstream diagnostic criteria in line with the clinical guidelines for diagnosis in ICD-11.
Okay, and Laura, I think you're the person left.
Yes, hi, I'm Laura Rowland, and I'm at NIMH. Jovier Evans and Liz Necka are my colleagues, so I fall into Jovier Evans' branch, the aging and geriatrics branch, and I handle the neuroscience portfolio. And before coming to NIMH, I did mainly schizophrenia research, neuroimaging, behavioral neuroscience. So I'm pleased to be here. I'm learning a tremendous amount. This is not my area of expertise.
All right. So our charge for the next 30 minutes is to sort of look back on the talks and conversation yesterday concerning the targets. And this is Maria's and Amy Byers, Nancy's and Alex's talk, which ranged from neurobiology to big data, I guess you'd say, and to think about how we take that information and everything else that everybody in this room knows and brings to the table to identify what we think are essential gaps in the research literature that we ought to be framing research to address, or barriers to that, potential treatments. I think this is a time for us to not come up with a definitive list, but to really start focusing on where we think this science and research should be going. So I'm going to leave that for someone to start talking.
Well, one thing that strikes me is just trying to place things, because the trajectory in the talks, at least in the organizing, was mechanisms, targets, interventions. But it seems like that entire pathway, there has to be some larger thing that ties them together, because I would think that you'd only be able to identify targets if you have some sort of a model or theory where some of the mechanisms are already understood. And then the idea then is to look at that model, or to look at mechanistic thinking, and then to examine, well, at what points in that process is there something that we can intervene on. And so the targeting, I think that the targeting needs to be relevant, related to some sort of a model, mechanistic model or something to do that. Also, they're just sort of levels of, it's like, what is the outcome? Because it's about suicide, but also about, this loneliness, social isolation, so that depending on what the ultimate outcome is, because the social isolation can be a target for suicide.
Absolutely. And the talks around the 3 days kind of went like this. And maybe that's partly the state of the science, where people have been approaching it from very different levels, from implementation / community, thinking about either social connectedness or suicide, all the way down to trying to understand. I try to understand all the time what Alex does, but he's not here, so I can't even pretend to understand what he does. So Amy, yes.
Oh, well, I was just gonna say, I think it's one of the things I know, at least with my work, because I use, a lot with, now I've gotten into the EHR data, I've used national probability samples. Most of the work I do is on big database stuff. Starting in late life depression, late life PTSD, and then now looking at suicide, and one of the things I keep coming back to, I mean, I've tried to write some grants looking at causation and trying to use the EHR data and trying to do these propensity score matching and trying all these fancy things to try to be like, let's see if I can get at mechanisms using EHR data. And at the end of the day, an RCT is probably going to be, if I'm going to try to look at anything with a medication or whatnot, or psychotherapy or whatnot, you need a randomized controlled trial, so to speak. And so when thinking mechanisms and thinking, at least the data I use, I think more in terms of indicators and markers. And then I get starting to think about vulnerable groups. And I think vulnerable groups, and I say that vulnerable, I know there's a lot of, how we phrase things now, we want to think about, are these really vulnerable individuals? And the work I'm doing with Lisa has really taught me something about older prisoners, and then older prisoners who, are coming out and reentering into community, they're a highly vulnerable group at this point of transition. Rihanna was just talking about transitioning to a nursing facility. That's a highly vulnerable time. So these vulnerable times, these vulnerable groups, and then you're talking about with prolonged grief disorder, that's a vulnerable, and cognitive issues, you know, around, you know, there's no supportive services. So I'm wondering about, like, can we think in terms of the targets, stepping back in a more macro level of who are the vulnerable groups? And then mechanistically, I do think it's going to take more work analytically to really think about that, because you're, when you talk causal pathways, you got to break it down at a pretty biological level.
I agree. I mean, one thing we've been struggling with when we're doing our intervention studies is who should we intervene on? And, you know, the measures sometimes that we use to screen people, I think are not, and this, Carla talked about this, are not sensitive enough. And I think sometimes we miss people because they don't want to reply to the questions. They don't want to say that they're lonely. They don't want to say they don't have a social network. And so it's very hard to determine who should be, you know, we do RCTs, who should we be including in these RCTs where we can really look at the sensitivity and the impact of our interventions. And I think that's, you know, I agree with your point.
I'd like to make a point about that, if that's okay. I mean, one of the problems I think we've had historically in suicidology, which we really haven't figured out how to reconcile or resolve, even temporarily, really is the problem of the phenotype. And because when you look at suicide, suicidal behavior, we've got very different classes of behavior. So you've got people who die by suicide, you've got suicide mortality. You've probably got maybe half a dozen different types of suicide attempt phenotypes. And then you've probably got about a dozen types of suicide ideation phenotypes. And then you've got death ideation phenotypes, and you've got, you know, reasons not to live phenotypes. And I think that what we keep doing here is we talk about intervention targets, but the assumption is that the target is important for a particular phenotype. The phenotype has been poorly defined. My interest, and this really does date back to the early work I did with Yates and Rochester, has been on suicide mortality. And I am convinced that there's a mortality phenotype that is really quite distinct from the attempt and ideation phenotypes that we typically study in the clinics and in community settings. And I was disappointed a number of years ago when NIMH decided, or somebody decided, that they didn't think it was worth really trying to define the phenotype anymore in suicidology, that there was really no need for flawed psychological autopsy studies. I think that was a huge mistake on the part of the US federal government and the people who were creating policy at that time. The psychological autopsy studies actually have gone on unimpeded in Europe and Australia and elsewhere. And I think we learn a lot through the psychological autopsy studies. The fact is that the phenotype that we are trying to target, right, is historically dynamic and socioculturally conditioned and economically driven. It's not the same. It's not the stable across time, culture, any kind of context. And until we figure that out and nail that, I just think we're gonna continue to kind of go around in circles here. A related point, and I'll stop, is localism. I think that once we understand that the phenotype is dynamic and socioculturally and sociohistorically and culturally conditioned, we understand that there's really a need for local culturally sensitive research on suicide. That is, that suicide mortality in Idaho is gonna look a little, in certain regions of Idaho is gonna look different than it does in Pittsburgh. And, you know, there's a role of federalism, I would say, in suicidology. Until we figure out sort of those political and policy making kinds of barriers to really doing this kind of research, I think we're going to go in circles. also a very brief shout out. I'm now getting into the prison work too. So Lisa, we should talk.
Right. Sounds great. Yeah.
So Vanetta is joining us. Thank you, Paul. There's a great deal to think about there. And thank you for making sure we're thinking about it. Vanetta, while you get your groundings, Brianna had something to say. And what we've done to this moment is we've introduced the people have introduced themselves if they didn't talk yesterday, and we're beginning a conversation. And I think Brianna was next.
Thank you. I wanted to say a couple of things, just reflecting on the great, amount of work that's been done on this topic. I've been thinking about just like, Jeffrey Rose had this paper in the 70s, sick individuals and sick populations, and that was a nice way to guide how we should think about the types of interventions, what is the risk of harm, right? And if the risk of harm is relatively low, then we would consider that as a potential for a universal intervention. And I was kind of struck during the conversation around what might the interventions be. Many of the things that we're talking about, it strikes me, unless I don't quite understand them, have very low risk of like an adverse effect, to me that means, and suicide is a rare event, and therefore kind of targeted or identifying subgroups is going to be a very inefficient way to address it. Just mathematically, it's going to be very inefficient. And so if the risk of side effect is low, the benefit, everyone would potentially benefit from more social interaction or less social isolation, or at least wouldn't be harmed by it, then that to me would point to the need for a universal intervention. And then to close on my comment, I wanted to have us think about something else that I think people for a long time thought was not preventable, which are traffic fatalities. And traffic accidents in this country have declined precipitously since the 1950s, even though there are far more people on the roads now. And you might say, well, why has that happened? Well, part of the way that's happened is because you don't have to think about it anymore, because our cars are safer. And because we have policies like seatbelts and airbags and things like that are built into your car, and you can't even buy an unsafe car anymore, right? And so it wasn't about individuals learning how to drive better. It was about changing the system and the ecosystem in which they exist. And so what I've been thinking about is like, what is the equivalent to like the back to, so the third, I guess, analogy is like, what's the equivalent for like of the back to sleep campaign for preventing SIDS for suicide? Where when we implemented that campaign, which was one of the most successful public health campaigns that we've ever had, we had really no idea as to what the neurobiology of how an infant slept was related to risk of sudden death. But it's true that sleeping on the back is better. And so that's a situation where the risk of harm, I'm sure there are some infants where like there's some potential harm to them, but like it's far outweighed by the potential for benefit, or the potential for no benefit, but just then no harm, right? So they weren't going to die of SIDS anyway. That's what I've been thinking about in this. And thank you for the Marty for the time.
Then I'm going to let Nancy jump in, and then we'll let everybody talk.
Actually, Brianna, I had like a different kind of a comment, but I'm wondering what you might think that universal intervention would look like, and how we would, who would deliver it? What would the manpower or woman power be like for that?
Yeah, I mean, so the other thing I was thinking is that I wrote down, and I basically, could COVID be the place where that is identified? Like, are we living in the moment of identifying that specific, are we living in the natural experiment right now, at least as it relates to social intervention? Can we make specific predictions about, we're seeing these surveys about depressive symptoms, da, da, da. I mean, Paul's point is very well taken, that there's suicides, just like there's depressions, there's not one phenotype, right? So we don't know if what, MMWR is telling us is going to be related to suicide risk down the line. But like, could we make some predictions about that? And then, I think it's probably not going to be delivered by mental health professionals, I guess, if that's sort of, in terms of like, not only is there just not enough human power to do such a thing, but I don't, to the degree, as Sarah was saying, like, people don't like admitting they're isolated. They don't like admitting the emotional distress that they're in. So the question is, like, do they not want to admit it to us, or do they just not want to admit it to anyone that they don't feel personally safe with, you know. I would say I have a colleague in Australia and they have this thing called man sheds, which is like a movement to have men get together to kind of help do things for the community, where they like build bikes or things or fix bikes or things like this for kids, you know, as a way to provide a different type of social role. And it is not, you know, it was completely developed, you know, by local people. And I don't know if it's just encouraging that sort of thing, funding that sort of thing.
I was on the National Academies Committee, and the whole purpose of that report ultimately was to make recommendations to healthcare systems for screening and developing partnerships with outside of the healthcare system in order to address social isolation and loneliness, you know, broadly. So it goes along with what you're saying, and it actually goes along in a certain way with my experience clinically here, and also in our observational research, is that as we're looking at like GDS scores, you know, we're seeing everybody, you know, a lot of elevated GDS scores now. And when we speak with participants, they want to be connected to community resources, and we don't readily have them. I mean, we can. So I do feel like there is a role for primary prevention. That said, I favor focusing on high risk groups just as a clinician, and also because I think that it gets around the problem of silos, you know, that if you recognize a high risk group, such as a bereaved person or a prolonged grief person, they could be identified in primary care, or they could be identified in mental health care. I think, or for that matter, cognitive impairment, that type of a patient or person can be seen in many different, you know, specialty areas, and someone has to make the connection that person might be at higher risk for, you know, behavioral symptoms or suicide or something. So I like the idea of recognizing either high risk situations like, or high risk profiles, you know, based on, you know, diagnoses.
I just make a comment about the universal prevention thing. So I think that's a great idea. I don't know that we've got a clear analog for older adults, like, you know, detoxifying domestic gas or anything like that. But I do think that, you know, we do potentially have the infrastructure available that could really make quite a dent in the suicide rate if we actually choose to use it. And we look globally and cross-nationally at the healthcare systems in other countries and the ways that they are ever able to leverage their personnel to go out and make visits to people's homes, whether they're nurses or they're physicians going out into community settings. You know, we've moved away from that in the United States a long time ago. And but it is useful to have, I think, a global perspective and see that just because we moved away from it doesn't mean that it completely went away. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I read a line by the primary care physician, Julian Tudor Hart. It was a Lancet article, 1971, I believe. And he just said something like, "The effect that I can have just by looking at my patient with a reassuring glance is immeasurable." And I think that's true. I think it's not just because Julian Tudor Hart was a human being, or is a human being, it's because he's a physician going out and seeing people in their homes. And we could do that if there was actually political will. And I do think, and there's actually some interesting research, you know, Barbara Starfield, eminent primary care researcher years ago published work looking at the effects of primary care practices on overall morbidity, you know, areas where there's a greater degree, greater penetrance of primary care practices have lower morbidity.
So Paul, I want to jump on your doctors and nurses. I think the work of Pat Rowley and Chip and my work, and I'm sure others, has really demonstrated that you can take less professionally trained people and community health workers and peers and all kinds of people to play that role and perhaps deal with the workforce issues. So I think we need to, with appropriate training, supervision, and so forth. So I think there's another strategy there.
Another group that you would know more than I, because I don't really work in suicide, but that I have been increasingly concerned with, especially since the CDC was looking at this during COVID, is informal caregivers. And as a target group, especially informal caregivers of patients with difficult diseases like Alzheimer's disease. And I know the CDC data that came out recently said that the prevalence of suicide ideation and thoughts about suicide has increased during the COVID. And I just think that that's another group that sometimes gets not swept under the carpet, but when we're targeting interventions for caregivers, they're thinking about isolation and suicide and those kinds of outcomes. I think that's another group that, you know, we have to consider and expand our vulnerable group definition, if you will.
I totally agree.
Marty, I'll add a comment building on Nancy, Paul, and Brianna's discussion about prevention. I think that the IOM lexicon of preventive interventions in mental disorders includes, as you guys know, not only universal, but also selective and indicated prevention strategies. And that may be a useful conceptual way of approaching prevention, not only of common mental disorders like depression, but potentially of some of its terrible sequelae, such as suicide. And Marty, as you were pointing out, there are data that suggests that indicated and selected prevention can be carried out by lay health counselors under appropriate supervision, helping us to deal with the workforce issues, not only in low and middle income countries, but also in large sections of North America as well.
Hi. I also wanted to add that I'm sorry, Vanetta.
Oh, yes, it's okay. First, I apologize that I had to take care of a little patient emergency, so I missed the first probably 20 minutes of this. But first, I had never introduced myself. I'm Vanetta Dotson at Georgia State. I'm a neuropsychologist by training. My research is in intersections of cognitive brain aging with depression. And so one of my interests is in anhedonia. And so we have anhedonia and apathy as these related, but separate concepts that I'm not sure if that's been addressed before I joined. But I do think that when we're talking about either target groups that are vulnerable and also just the impact of these confounding factors that can make it harder to implement some of these interventions, that that's going to be important because there's going to be less motivation for some of the social interactions and things that we're trying to do to deal with loneliness. And so it seems like that needs to be addressed simultaneously in people. And then also kind of looking out for older adults who have more of those apathy and anhedonic symptoms that might be a particularly vulnerable group. So I just wanted to add that.
This is Maria. I just wanted to comment that I think much of the conversation has appropriately focused on addressing the social isolation and social disconnection quite directly. But I think that there are also consequences of the social disconnection that might be appropriate targets, such as insomnia or increased aggressive behavior. And I think the biological data is only accumulating, but I think we probably need to use a multi-pronged approach to this.
I just wanted to bring up, as you know, we're hearing about different phenotypes and about the differences between kind of targeting really high risk groups that I think Nancy was talking about, and also Demetrius Kiosis in his talk, versus sort of more lower risk, but you know, folks with, you know, increased isolation and loneliness, but who do not have a history of attempts, for example, that, you know, Chip and I and Marty do. And I think, just wanted to get back to the idea of targets. And I think that folks are saying, I'm trying to digest it, that the targets could differ depending on obviously the group that's studied, and that I think that targets can also differ by the type of providers, you know, highly skilled clinician versus a lay provider or a peer could be hitting different targets by which suicidal ideation is reduced. If I'm just trying to digest everything, but.
I think something we haven't really discussed yet is that both of these constructs, social connectedness and suicide, there's a lot of potential different outcomes of lack of social connectedness. There's a lot of different risk factors for suicide. And I think part of the challenge is knowing, do we need to know that the effect of our interventions are specific to suicide risk, or is it good enough to reduce social connectedness? And it is, we need to know that it's through social connectedness that we're reducing suicide risk, or is it through other things? Just put that out there. Koch principles or someone like that in public health? Well,
I think the other thing is like the timeliness, like how, one of the other comments I really appreciated today was like the idea of how much, over what time, right? Because, you know, even if we're talking about like getting some, you know, suicide risk varies by the more people die by suicide on Mondays than Fridays, right? So like even at that type of very acute timeliness, there's variation. And so are we just literally talking about getting somebody to Tuesday so then I can increase the likelihood that they make it through the end of the week? Or am I talking about over a lifespan? So when people arrive in their 70s or 80s and go through bereavement and go through this shrinking kid network, which is all of these things are going to happen. How do we, you know, and I guess that's why I guess I want to push back again against the idea of the high-risk subgroup, because I do think the analogy of traffic fatalities is relevant here, because it's a totally different way of thinking about prevention, and it might not address all suicides, right? Just like we do have, you know, we're gonna have driverless cars and they're gonna reduce a certain different type of accident, right? That's happening, right? And there are different modifications that people make, whether it's they don't drive at night or they don't drive when it's raining, right? So it's not that there's not a place for individual type things, but I think when the exposure that we're talking about, sorry, my son needs me, but I'll finish and then mute myself, is that we are talking about social connectedness. And so I think the idea that we should start addressing that in a physician's office is a little strange when I have my cancer doctor, I have a very strong relationship with them. All my other doctors are there to help me get the medications I want to get to, for example, like it's a totally different relationship. I don't want that from them, except for the one that I have to see all the time. You know what I mean? So it's a different kind of, it's strange to me, I guess, to think that like that's where people want their social connectedness addressed. I don't know that that assumption is true.
Well, especially,
Yeah,
I'm just thinking there's the social, you know, social causes of, you know, isolation and suicidal thoughts and behaviors. Is that if the cause is a social, society-wise cause, then some kind of effort to prevent that would be like some public health initiative to make the culture less coarse, to have people more comfortable interacting with each other and having social relationships. I feel like there's a trend where the culture, broader culture, has just gotten more coarse, and it's just a rougher terrain to try to have close connections.
I'd also get back to what Martha was just raised, and I think that brings us kind of full circle to what Paul said in terms of the needs of having some kind of model or something to guide where we're going, so to help identify targets and proximal and distal outcomes. And I think that's one thing we've been struggling with when we're putting together some of our, at least we have with our interventions.
Well, I was wondering if, I keep going back to Julianne Holt-Lundstedt's first talk, and when she shows the data on mortality and the idea that complex measures of social disconnection have a higher, you know, effect on mortality than individual measures. And just this idea that there are three or four core aspects of social disconnection, you know, the the integration, you know, the qualitative, the functional, and perhaps negative social interactions, and just approaching any person or any person in a high-risk group according to those maybe four categories or three categories, and developing some kind of a risk score, and whether or not that could be used, you know, at a population level, or if it could be used, you know, when we're assessing someone clinically, and if we could intervene in those particular categories, because that kind of matches up with my clinical experience, that people can be socially disconnected in very different, you know, in these different domains. And for some people, one domain is more important than another, but the combination of that, those disconnected domains probably is really important.
I'm going to interrupt just a second, and then whoever keeps talking. We're out of time, but we're doing some back room working to see if the other groups want more time too, so that we can go forward for a little bit more time. What's going on? Go ahead.
I just want to piggyback on Brianna's point earlier about the tension between high-risk groups versus more universal. I mean, universal is not a great term, I don't think, but I mean, it does bear remember that most older adults, particularly men who die by suicide, die in their first attempt, right? So they're not going to be identified as high-risk. It's also worth remembering that people who have severe and persistent suicide ideation are more likely to be involved in the mental health system than people who don't, yet people who never report suicide ideation to a mental health practitioner somehow end up dying by suicide. So it's a problem there with both the phenotypes and the way we think about risk, which from my perspective really does push me more toward a public health sort of intervention. In fact, that's what I did. I moved from a psychiatry department to a school of public health. I do think if we could figure out a way to develop environments that afford a greater degree of connectedness, we will go far away. I mean, I think we need to be working with architects, with urban planners. These things, these feelings of social connectedness and our ability to communicate and integrate and interact with other people are not just products of things in our brains, but really are products of our environments, and we're not really aware of them. We just need to have really smart environmental planners working with us.
Thank you. As someone who moved from a school of public health to a department of psychiatry, Amy is raising her hand vigorously.
I was like, I'm dying to talk. So I don't think it's about universal versus high risk. I actually think it's all of it. I think universal prevention includes looking at groups that are, because we're talking about different environments, right? And I think it isn't about having, I got to have this relationship with my clinician. It's about, at least for me, is when I talk to my clinical colleagues, it's like, they're telling me, they're like, yeah, mom, my patient was hopeless. They told me about it. They told me they're socially isolated. They told me that. But listening and being aware and educating, that those are important metrics to listen to. And I think it's kind of like if we were a nonprofit and we had like this mission statement and then we had this vision, my vision as an epidemiologist and a public health person would totally be universal prevention. But as a pragmatic person, realizing like, okay, what can we really do now? What can we do right now that helps support that vision in the future is to look at where can we target people? Where are the important points over time of these transitions, and have it move into a message, a universal message. But I don't think that's where I don't think we can really realistically start there.
Okay, so I'm gonna have the last word because we have to leave, but not only points and people, but locations, where are there opportunities? Thank you. We could talk all day, of course, but we have to go back to the rest of the group. And so I think Twinell's gonna, I guess we can all leave the room. Don't leave the meeting, just leave the room, and we'll be bounced back into the big group. This is a real pleasure, and it's really fun to have a chance to have everybody talking together. So we'll see you in 2 seconds.